Hello everyone, I am C.S. Aboli Pitre and I welcome you all to the very first lecture of my series on company law. Companies in general play a very important role in our lives. They not only contribute towards economic development of the country, but they are integral part of our daily lives as well. They provide us with employment. They manufacture a lot of goods that we consume. They provide us with investment alternatives. We read about them every day in news in one way or another. Let's understand the very basics of what exactly is a company, where it is defined, what are its characteristics that make it so unique and different from other types of business organization, why company is the most preferred form of business organization when it comes to carrying on medium to large scale business operations. Let's understand all of that in today's lecture. In simple terms, if we have to understand what exactly is a company, we can say it is individual or group of individuals coming together in order to achieve certain common objective, like performing some kind of trade, business or profession, and they want to earn some profit at the end of the day. Also, Article 19(1)(c) of our Indian Constitution gives us freedom to form association. Therefore, we have the freedom to form any kind of company that we want to. If we have to see the definition of company, it is given in Companies Act 2013. It says in its Section 2, Subsection 20, company means company registered under this Act or any other previous Act. This definition does not give us any idea as to what differentiates company, how to recognize a company, or what are its characteristics and features. To understand that, let us first see all the characteristics of company that makes it so unique. Once we have understood all the characteristics of company, we can make our own definition, which will help us understand company just by mere reading of it. It will also help us to remember all the characteristics at once. So, let's start by understanding all the characteristics one by one. The first and the most important characteristic of company is its separate legal existence independent of the members, that is the persons who form the company, and independent of the directors who run the company. Why this is the most important characteristics is because it differentiates company from other type of business organizations, and secondly, all the other characteristics that we are going to discuss further, all are related to this characteristic. In order to understand separate legal existence of company, we need to see one concept which is widely used in law, that is called as legal person or artificial person. In our daily lives, when we say the word person, we generally talk about naturally born individual like you and me. However, in law, the word person not only includes the naturally born individual, but it goes further and it also gives individuality and personality to some artificially formed entities like company. Because according to law, person means anyone who is capable of having its own rights and liabilities. Law gives separate individuality, personality to company, and therefore company is considered a separate person having its own rights and liabilities independent of the members and directors. To understand it further, let's see one of the most celebrated case law regarding company's separate legal existence. The name of the case is Salmon versus Salmon and Company Limited. In this case, let's first understand the facts. Mr. Salmon was a shoe manufacturer and he was doing pretty good business on his own. He was a sole proprietor. He further wanted to extend his business operations, so he decided to form a company. In this company, along with him, his other six family members were also members. And they held only one share each. However, Mr. Salmon held 20,000 shares in that company. It was given to him in exchange of the business of the shoe manufacturing being transferred to the company. Also, he was given 10,000 debentures, which were secured debentures of £1 each. These debentures were backed by the assets of the company. That's why that made Mr. Salomon not only member but also secured creditor of the company. After continuing the business operation in the form of company for around 1 year, the company went into huge losses and it was decided to wind up its operation. While winding up the operation, the process is such that all the assets of the companies are sold, the money is collected, and that money is repaid to the people to whom company owes the money, that is creditors of the company. While making the payment to creditors, the preference is given to secured creditors and then unsecured creditors are repaid. Accordingly, Mr. Salmon, being secured creditor of the company, as he was the holder of secured debentures which were backed by assets of the company, he got the money which he had in the form of 10,000 debentures back. However, after making payment to him, no money was left to make payment to unsecured creditors of the company. Now, what unsecured creditors did is, they challenged this payment of debenture money back to Mr. Salmon, as they contended, though technically Mr. Salmon and Salmon and Company Limited are two separate entities. However, in this case, Mr. Salmon are holding almost all the shares of the company, and therefore any payment made by company to him should be considered as payment made by him to himself. And therefore this payment should not be considered as valid, and that money should be used to repay the unsecured creditors. In this case, the court, that is the House of Lords, held that once the company is duly registered and incorporated by following the process of law, no matter what, it continues to have its separate legal existence independent of its members and directors. The mere fact that majority of the shares, or let's say almost all the shares, are held by one single member does not make any change to this status of the company. In no shape or form, company acts as a trustee or agent of any of the members. Also, there is nothing in law that stops the family members from owning all the shares of one company. Even if all the shares of the company are held by one family, still the company will continue to have its existence independent of the family members. And therefore, in this case, Mr. Salmon and Salmon and Company Limited cannot be considered as one single entity. And the payment made to Mr. Salmon was considered to be valid. The emphasis given to company's independent and separate legal existence is something that makes this case really important. The second characteristic of company is limited liability of its members. This feature is really important from the perspective of members who are willing to invest its money in the company, because it really limits the liability that they have to face in case of winding up of the company. To understand it further, we need to know that there are two types of companies. First type is company limited by shares, and second type is company limited by guarantee. When we say the company is limited by shares, the liability of member is limited to the face value of the shares held by it in the company. For example, I hold 100 shares in Tata Motors Limited. The face value of the share of Tata Motors Limited is rupees 2 each. Therefore, in case the company goes into winding up, the liability of me as a member will be limited only to 200 rupees, and no extra money can be claimed from me in order to repay the loans or creditors of the company. Also, if the case is regarding company limited by guarantee, such company may or may not have share capital. In this case, each member of the company gives guarantee to company of certain amount. His liability is limited to the amount guaranteed by him. So, in case of winding up of the company, the liability of that member will be limited only up to the amount which he has given at the time of taken membership as guarantee to company. This characteristic is really important from the perspective of members, because in worst case, their liability is always limited and they are aware up to what amount they will be held liable in the case of winding up of the company. Next important feature of company is transferability of shares. The shares held by member in the company are always transferable. Depending on the type of company, how easy it is to transfer the share may differ. However, each share of company is transferable. In case of private company, its article of association, that is the document which tells us about how the company will be governed, may give certain conditions to be fulfilled in order to transfer the shares. However, it cannot make it impossible to transfer the share. In case of public company, transferability of shares is more than private company. It is very easy to transfer the shares if you are holding shares in listed public company. However, all the shares of any company are always transferable. This is important from the perspective of company as well as members, as any member, whenever he feel like, can take his investment made in that shares out of the company. The next important feature of company is its perpetual succession. Company continues to exist unless and until it is deliberately wound up by the members or by the operation of law, as the case may be. This is possible because, as we have already seen, company has its existence independent of its members and directors. So the members of the company may keep on changing from generations to generation. The board of directors of the company will undergo change. Company itself will go through a lot of transition and changes to keep up with changing times. However, it continues to exist for years together. This makes the company really favorable type of business organization, as it ensures longevity of the business for a really long amount of time. Next, three characteristics of company are interlinked, and therefore we will discuss it together. First of these three is separate property, means ability of company to own property in its own name. Company can hold, own, sell, alienate, lease, gift any property which it holds or owns in its own name. It is completely independent of the members or directors. No one except company can have any interest in property of the company. For that, one of the important case law is Makora versus Northern Assurance Company Limited. In this case, the company was in the business of timber manufacturing. Mr. Makora was majority shareholder of the company and he was also creditor of the company. As we know, timber is really perishable. It was required to be insured. In this case, Mr. Makora, he took the insurance of the timber was destroyed due to some reason, and Mr. Makora claimed the insurance of that timber. According to law of insurance, the person who is taking the insurance should have some kind of insurable interest in the property that he is getting insured. And Mr. Makora here claimed that as he is the majority shareholder of the company as well as creditor of the company, he has insurable interest in the property of the company. However, it was held by the court that no person, not even member, has insurable interest in the property of the company. Company has its own separate legal existence and is completely capable of managing its own property. Next characteristics is ability to enter into the contract. This is directly related to earlier characteristic. Now, when we see company on its own can manage its own property, it will be required to enter into multiple contracts in order to do so. If company wants to sell the property or purchase new property or give the property on lease to someone, it will be required by it to enter into some kind of contract. Therefore, the next characteristic says that company is completely capable of entering into contracts in its own name. The next characteristic is ability of company to sue or be sued in its own name. Let's assume that company has entered into some contract with third party and there is a breach of that contract by that third party. Here, company has the ability and capacity to sue anyone in its own name. At the same time, if the company commits the breach in that contract, the third party, who is another party to the contract, can definitely sue company in its own name and claim the damages as the case may be. It is also important to know that company can even sue its own members and directors and vice versa. The last characteristics of company which makes it unique is separation of ownership and management. Company generally performs business in medium to big scale. It requires certain level of competency, knowledge, experience to run big organizations. Therefore, the board of directors is appointed. We have discussed all the characteristics of company. Now, as discussed earlier, let's make our own definition of company, which on its bare reading will help us understand what exactly is a company. That definition is, company is an artificial person having separate legal existence, which has perpetual succession and transferable shares, with ability to hold and own property and capacity to sue and be sued in its own name. This definition will help you not only understand but also remember all the characteristics of company in one go. I hope now the concept of company, its definition and its characteristics are clear to you. If you have any query or question regarding the same, feel free to ask them in the comment section below. Don't forget to share this video with all your friends who are interested in knowing and studying the company law. Thank you very much.